It kind of reminds me of what the elders used to say, you know, and talk about the canoes journeying to other villages and having potlatches, feeding the people, getting to know each other. And I've only heard these things, and I've only seen pictures of these things, and to see it actually happen, it just kind of puts a big lump in my throat.
Channels canoes from the west coast, the outside of Vancouver Island. Started in their own villages and moved down the coast. The Quinault, the whole river, they all paddled up to Nuu Bay. The inland canoes, they also started just across from Nuu Bay, and they crossed the Straits of Juan de Fuca to the village of Nuu Bay. There was one stop before they got to Elwha, and that was Clallam Bay. They camped there and then ended up in Lower Elwha, in our mouth. The way the bar is set for when you're crossing into a river from the Straits of Juan de Fuca, you have to go against your own nature. You have to bring your canoe in sideways with the surf. Unfortunately, a couple of canoes, they went over and it got a little bit wet. But they were all okay, and everybody knew what they were doing, so everybody was safe. Nobody got hurt.
I've heard a lot of people, you know, when they get to their destination in the journey, wherever they're traveling to, that they're looking for healing. And I know that it's a lot of healing for a lot of people. For others, it's strength, their strength and their spirit. For me, I'm just really concerned about the younger generation. They talk about the link to the future, and that our elders, were the ones that's gone on before, is the link to the past. To me, I just love to see that the younger people are participating, because it is an alcohol-free, drug-free, smoke-free journey.
Because of my alcohol and drug addictions, I remember a time nobody wanted to speak to me. And I just, you know, I just dread going back there again, you know. I'm afraid. I'm afraid, you know, my next drink, it might be my last. I wish I could just continue it from one year to the next, staying strong, you know, instead of going on a journey and then not participating in drumming and singing and paddling until the next journey. You know, I don't have no room for errors.
And it also helps me, you know, to see this come to pass, because in the past, there was nothing, no canoes at all. But when they started their paddle to Seattle, then it just kind of picked up from there. Then pretty soon everybody was involved to actually see all the canoes on the beach, on the shores of different destinations that we go. And it brings our people closer together. It brings our tribes closer together. You know, and where there's no hard feelings against each other, you know, where, like there was in the past.
Teachings on the water seem like they never ever end. Instead of having a break come right up to our bar and shallow out where the deepest part of the river is, there's a break that went all the way across the bar of our river. And some of the skippers are just, they're very patient individuals, and they knew right when to wait, and they knew when they should have went. And they made it all right. Like in our canoe, it was loaded up with a full crew of 18. They just went at the wrong time. They got sideways in the surf, got filled up full of water. Everybody was all right, but everybody was soaking wet. We knew there'd be a lot of wind because it was July. In the waters of the Straits of Juan de Fuca, it's always blowing in July. That's when they say the sockeye move is in the wind. And at that time, the wind was blowing 15 to 25, and it was expected to get worse. So without putting anyone in harm's way, we decided to paddle our canoes upstream, upriver, to a road that drives all the way to the river's edge. And we trailered all of the canoes from that point there into Port Angeles.
This forerunner's going into town. It's going following the canoes. There's four people that can ride with her.
A lot of the other skippers were, they supported our decision to not want to paddle into Port Angeles in weather like that. A lot of the crews had younger peoples. We had the means of trailering them, and they didn't object. It was for the safety of all the people in our territories.
Whether it be soaking in the water, fasting, sweating in a sweat lodge, you need to prepare yourself. You can't just jump in a canoe and go, you know, it's not that easy. I was into alcohol and drugs when I was younger. For a number of years, I experimented. But these canoes and the paddling, the singing and the drumming, the fasting, the sweat lodge, these are God's tools. These are what bring you closer to God.
We decided that we were going to go to Hollywood Beach, which was the place where the canoes were desecrated. Some conference peoples had been at the restaurant hotel in Port Angeles and had taken alcohol out to the canoe sites where they were staged and urinating on them, basically, is the story I heard. It disturbed me. So that was my main motivation for doing canoe security for this particular journey, was that the 24/7 is necessary, because canoes are like people. They are our people. You know, the spirit of the canoe is what carries us. The next morning at 6:30, you know, right after sunrise, some of the spiritual people, spiritual leaders came down and performed a purification ceremony. They sang some songs to clear any negative impacts from the previous journey so that our people would be able to leave in a good way, in a blessed way, that they wouldn't have any of those thoughts that would inhibit their mental or their spiritual being. It was a good ceremony that was performed by the spiritual leaders of Lower Elwha and some other peoples from Macaw, I think, I believe. They were relatives of most of the Polish. I felt there was a great clearing of any emotions that were not being dealt with. And so after that, they all pulled out and we staged them and pushed them out and headed to Jamestown.
I was 16 years old when I started, and a lot of these kids they're still in middle school. Watched a lot of these kids get really frustrated with themselves. And then when they get there, you know, they're just happy. They're really happy. They're very proud of what they just accomplished. The amount of miles that they went through, the things that they got to see in the water. That's the other great thing.
We come around a corner, booking. We're about 10 miles an hour. We got a whole bunch of seals, most of the big seals in this country.
Look at how this is hot.
These are all young, real young people. There's no argument. They're all together. They're pulling together. They're learning. They have teachings from their grandparents.
We are still in solemn territory. It's good to be home to this village here. Very happy to be here. Welcome. Come ashore.
Yes, you're all welcome. The chief of this clan welcomes all of you to come ashore. Anu Ai Sipan. Ashore, Nazi Kong.
In each camp that you go, each camp that different villages have, and you can see it, how strong they are.
You made that too? Very nice.
So how many people are camping here tonight?
Well, there was 1,000 in Elwha, so there'll be probably 1,500 here, maybe 16.
Yeah. It looks like it's a little bit wrong on the front.
Okay, that whoever screwed that one in there did a good job. Boy, that's tight.
Okay. See?
Recognition and acknowledgement does a great deal for some young people who struggle with who they are and where they're at and where they're going.
A lot of them have given up some bad habits to be in the canoe. And I can't imagine anyone not wanting to be in the canoe.
They got to Jamestown, you know, and they'd landed, and they were all happy. And I went around and personally ask everyone in the youth, did you pull? And they would get their big grin and smile, and I'd shake their hand and give them a hug and say thank you. And I was very appreciative of their being able to perform a task such as the one they just finished and going to Jamestown.
And I can't believe how young they are starting. Some of them, I don't think they're even 10 years old.
It was just kind of accidental. I thought she was going to watch her little brother a day that we had practice, and she didn't have to. And they were saying they were encouraging kids this young to come, so she came out with us, and she liked it. I never dreamed that was going to be possible for a few more years. So it was wonderful to have her and my other daughter, her aunt, Jessica. It was wonderful.
Can you tell me how old Sonia is?
She's 12. She turned 12 in May.
And they keep talking about youth being in the canoes, but I don't want to give it up yet. My dad is from Queen Charles Islands. His name is Douglas Eden Chah, son of Henry Eden Chah, grandson of Albert Eden Chah. My mother is Haida from Heidelberg, Raven of the Bear House. They are so busy up there. My relatives are so busy. They have a lot of canoes. They're all carvers and canoe builders.
And if anybody's interested in hula lessons, you see this short little lady in the back over here.
Next, I'd like to introduce the Katie family.
Hands on your hip, please. Hands on your hip.
This is our roots. This is our original home here. My family was very, very large when we first started. I had 11 grandchildren. But they all grown up now, and I just have 3-4 left. We're going to sing our first song, a song about the swan song. It's a song that came to my wife's great-grandfather, Solomon Bouch, when he had a little farm up in Lummi many years ago.
Oh, yeah, Juanito Salalita, oh, hey.
There was a little pond. Every year these swans would come down and nest in this pond. They would introduce themselves as they would come to the pond. In the springtime, when they're getting ready to go north, they would circle the farm and bid him farewell.
Oh, I'm one of the skippers. I'm the carver of our canoe. Help get the people ready, so they're ready to pull, you know, for the potlatch that we're going to in Tulalip. I help play a small part with a lot of other people from our village,
doing some paint,
getting things organized for our crew to be able to travel.
Come on in.
For our hosting that took part in Port Angeles. In Lower Elwha.
about all of your experiences.
Yeah, we landed right in the downtown section of Port Townsend. Kind of like the tourist capital of Olympic Peninsula.
Kind of. Please rest and share.
It was good to share with them who we are. We're still in our territories, the Clown people. And that chunk of land there through Port Townsend, they say that's where Chetsmuk lived. And he was one of our very respected chiefs of the Clown peoples. So that's why we landed in Point Hudson right there, is because that's where his home was at one time. Right next to Chetsmuk Park.
I'm Glenn Henningford, one of the Jefferson County Commissioners, and I'm honored to be here today to join in this events that you have taking place here in Port Townsend. We welcome you to Jefferson County and the city of Port Townsend. This journey 2003, I'm very proud to be a small part of that. And I see a lot of things going on that are good things with all your people. We're very glad to have you here. I'm sure this journey is very important to all your pullers, and I bet this journey will serve them well in the future. So it's a very special event for me. On behalf of the county commissioners, the people of Jefferson County, we'd like to give you this small gift thanking you for being here in Port Townsend. Welcome.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
I would like to say thank you for your warm welcome. I'd like to thank you for making your shores available to us. It's really something for us to retrace the steps of our ancestors. My grandmother told me that she used to come here as a young girl, and they used to come here and fish. And to know that we're landing upon the same shores that my grandmother did in her canoes with her family and everything has a very special meaning to me. And for us to be gathering the way that we're gathering in the teachings and ways of our ancestors is very, very important. Our theme here this year is healing through unity. My nephew translated that in our language, and it says we make ourselves stronger through our gatherings. We get to share in the wisdom of our elders. We get to share in the wisdom and the teaching of the different tribes that are represented.
Show them who we are, the pride that we have here, the drums, the culture.
The story comes that you traveled 18 hours, that the wind took you to another direction. That island is called Protection Island. It's a safe place to be. The old ones were there to welcome you. Speak people and the great host that you are when we come into your territory. We know that you come from the chiefs up north.
Some very, very powerful singers and some very powerful dancers that we would like to share with your community. Because our culture is alive, it's a living culture. Thank you, Mary.
What a brave thing you guys did, crossing the straits.
I think, you know what, I really think that people need to understand too that a lot of our elders taught us that when you do something, you believe in it, you got to have trust in it. And that's exactly what we did. We never had any doubts when we seen the waves come and seen the 12, 15 foot swells come. We never gave it a second thought. It was coming on to us from the sides, from the front, from the back. And you know, I'm no kidding when you got these big barges coming behind you. And there was only two that really slowed down for us, you know, just stopped and just glided by us, eh? But like I said, when you believe in what you do, then you know, there's no chance to, you know, I guess what people call failures. You know, so we believed we can do this yesterday. We did it.
You know, our grandfather is a canoe builder, and when I'm standing in the back of the canoe, I can see everything that's going on, and I can make the canoe move left or right or stop, go backwards. Think about the design of our canoes that we're building today, and how, you know, our ancestors used to travel around when they'd be going to a potlatch or going hunting. Or going harvesting, how would they be doing it? You know, would there be 18 people in a big canoe like this, or would there be six or seven in two big sails? You know, so you get a lot of time to think while you're on the water.
I always have a lot of people that'll come over to our shop when myself, Al, or John, or whomever's there, come over and express to us how proud they are about the work that a lot of us and so many other people are doing. And when we take on young people and bring them into the shop and have them work with us, or when we have classes, just how happy they are that their son or daughter or granddaughter or grandson was in our class with us.
Oh, this is just nice. This is just right.
Oh, can you see it? Can you see it? Boy, they're in a hurry. I'm gonna be too. Look at them go.
And I pulled with my cousin, the skipper of the Elwha Spirit, you know, almost every time he's asked me. And he asked me a few times, what are you gonna do? And I said, well, I'm ground crew, man. I look at him and he'd look at me, and there was that look like, you know, that we're coming to understanding here too, that it's just, it looks like you have a full crew. You know, these young people are here and they're ready and they're willing and they're waiting. And that gave me a great feeling, that to know that I could step back and there's going to be these young people, you know, not just one young person, but, you know, two, three, four, five young people who are just waiting and wanting and believing in this journey, this part of their life.
And they're having a lot of fun. We had a chance to talk last night, and
They're having a lot of fun.
I think one of the first things they learn is respect. In order to be able to respect others, they have to learn to respect themselves, and especially the elders that we have with all our groups, and many elders here.
This journey right here to Port Gamble means a lot to me. This is where my grandfather is buried, and this is my son.
Hi!
And this is my other son. But yeah, my grandfather is buried here, so it means a lot to come here. My grandmother's from here, so...
Auntie Jane.
Yep.
Yeah.
Everybody's Grandma Jane.
Yeah, Grandma Jane.
And so when she watches those come ashore, I know she'll be real happy and excited and proud.
We went to Port Gamble. It's just the land of the sun. That's where the Port Gamble village site was.
It was really nice to see this old style canoe come in with Harry Moon Skipper, and I hadn't seen my cousin in some time, but he was pulling with Harry Moon, and I'd been trying to get him on the water.
Well, I'm going to paddle as much as I can because I've been in quite a few accidents in my life, and I'm pretty sore in a lot of different places. I just want to do what I can, where I can, and when I can, as much as I can. You know, I just want to be here to help out. You know, I take it one step at a time, day by day, breath by breath, moment by moment.
We're going to land our canoe first because we're going to come in and help sing and welcome you guys here. Yeah, we'll be leading. But Elwha and Jameson will come in after the cause.
We got three canoes.
Okay. So those three canoes.
Are we ready?
It was incredible for me to, I think the first time I noticed how many of them there were was probably pulling into Port Gamble, and the numbers kept growing. The year 2001, I decided to try it. Actually, I only intended to try it for a day or so, and then, because I'd been lifting weights, and I don't know, Jesse and I decided we'd give it a try. We'd always been involved with softball and just had kind of incidental exposures to the journey. And so we decided to try it, and then I found that I wasn't that hard on me physically, and so I made arrangements to go on the rest of the journey. And that's where we went up to Squamish.
Up to now, we've been 15 days in the water to here, over 2 weeks, and long ways.
Just at the beach and there's a lot of boats out there, and there's a lot of people and a lot of crab.
Yeah.
It makes me feel really good to see the dinners that they serve the elders first. And,
get away from me!
Our young people learn that, they see it. In our group, we get a chance of our elders to talk to our youth and teach them about many different things, protocols and culture and songs.
Every time you folks come to our reserve, it gets more of our community involved. Now you can take a look at every community member. There's somebody from every one of our families. There's somebody from every one of the departments in our tribal government are here. These journeys have drawn our tribe closer together.
I was going to college and I had a summer to myself, usually an opportunity to earn some dough for college expenses. We needed to work. So I staying with my uncle in the Lummi area. In between my work, I would go down to the beach and watch the boats, and one of which, or two of which, was an 11-man canoe. And unfortunately, there was a bad incident to take place at this time, and that is one of them was a logger, and by day, and he was killed in a logging accident in the woods. There was a vacancy, and the captain of one of the canoes saw me standing there watching. He knew I came down every day, and he asked me if I'd like to go for a ride. And of course, I'd like to get in one of those big canoes. On the 3-mile jaunt that they were in the habit of taking, they didn't slow down or cut it short because I was new to the canoe. I was just in there fresh as an onlooker, and I took a beating, of course.
We ended up in Squamish, which is excellent. It was a long time since I've been to Squamish, huh? It was 14 years ago. That was the first time I was there by canoe. It kind of had a just waves of emotions, kind of. I was reminded of how I felt back in 1989, you know, when I was a teenager. Scenario is almost the same. It was during the evening time, you know, it's really warm out, it's kind of blowing out, and it was almost the same, it seemed like it.
Then there's Squamish. That was another sight because I got to pull from Port Gamble, and we rafted up and we shared some singing, some talking, and some prayers. And the young people that were there, it was very impromptu. The Chief Nelson of his nation, First Nations of Canada, he's very, very well-spoken, and his teachings are very beneficial to those that are around him when he speaks. And the young people that we had in his canoe, we shared some pullers with his canoe and his nephew's canoe. Pulling up the canoes, you know, that was one of the hardest things to do. The reason why I believe it was difficult is not only due to the size of them, but the respect that the canoes have. To participate in the care and the comforting of those canoes and putting them to rest on the beach, and to do it in an appropriate way, in an appropriate manner, with comfort and care and security. That's a memory that I will be talking about and sharing with people that I come across the remainder of my years.
Take that rock right there, flip the fish.
How far did you go today?
That's right.
Nautical miles, I'm not sure.
How long did it feel like?
Oh, 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 oh.
each time you sing a song, you give a lot of that spirit to the people. When you do that, then it comes back tenfold. It provides, you know, the growth and the molding of the spirit of the young people. And it's always our encouragement to the young people. When they're molding their spirit, they're molding the spirit of their family. There's new songs every year. Songs that probably will become a part of all the future journeys that we're going to be involved in. It allows some of the communities that haven't been able to really exercise because of, you know, the dilemma that many of our First Nations people have had. You know, the outlaw, the potlatch. Some of our nations haven't fully recovered from that, but doing it this way, when you allow sharing, it you know, provides you an opportunity to kind of go forward to learn the songs and to learn the process. At this time, I fully am aware that our Creator has had a lot to do with all of these things happening. It doesn't happen for nothing. Our people are so committed to be able to hold on to this great circle that has been formed in the last few years.
We're there, one more day to go, you know. It's pretty exciting. Very exciting at that point. Because I knew it was the last day, you know. We've done enough of these to kind of know what to expect. A lot of these young people, they couldn't understand why we were waking them up at 5 o'clock in the morning.
This is it, this is the last leg, and we're at our destination.
It was actually the longest part of the whole trip was the last day. We didn't tell them that though.
Thank you, Creator, for all the good food that you provided for my warrior.
The day was beautiful, you know. When we left, I threw in as many kids as I possibly could, because they'll remember that day. Before we even got to Tulalip, we stopped on an island. Well, once we got out of the Puget Sound, we stopped on an island, Whidbey Island. That was really cool. Just everybody hanging out, eating their lunches, relaxing. We stayed there probably for 20 minutes, visiting with all of the canoes that were taking part in the journey. There's canoes for probably a quarter of a mile, you know, all up and down the beach, just brought up at all different angles, different lengths, different paint jobs. And then we paddled to this island just across from Tulalip, across the bay.
Oh,
we came around the corner and there was just canoes, boats, people, just all over the place, all up and down the beach. Really neat. I've gotten the chance to know a lot of these people personally, a lot of not just the skippers but a lot of the crews from all the other canoes. Every year, you know, you always meet somebody new, you know, or I'm off this canoe, I used to be on this canoe and now this year I'm traveling on this one. It's a very proud thing, you know, seeing all those canoes lined up. For working on canoes, it's a very proud time as a builder. I know a lot of the other canoe builders, and you can see the pride that they have and their sacred vessels that they help form and all the people in them, you know? And it's doing such a great thing for their community.
Halfway across and you could look and you could see the whole hillside moving around over here. It's a pretty overwhelming feeling when you see that many people standing around waiting for all their canoes and the other canoes to come in. It's an overwhelming feeling.
I could feel that, you know, getting closer to Kalela, you know, that my role is going to change even more so. And getting to Kalela, we waited, and it was hot. The elders showed up, one of my grandmoms showed up, and the elders and the crew, ground crew. Just watching the expressions on the elders' faces, and that of the mothers, the fathers, the aunties, the uncles. It's just a wonderful moment to be able to witness that, to be there, and to be a part of it, a shared experience with our community, where the pride, the satisfaction, the admiration, being here as a community, being here as a family, being here as a crew member, however you wanted to identify it. It all came together and it was all okay. It was all right to be who you were today, be who you are today. Sing about it, to be able to dance, to see the looks on the members of each canoe as they look for faces of recognition in the crowd, and to have thousands of people here on shore, you know, raising their voices in recognition of the accomplishment that the canoes and the ground crew people had accomplished on this day when they landed here in Tulalip. They'll be telling stories about this. They'll tell their kids. Their kids will tell their kids. You know, and for the rest of that young person's life, that story will be told. And this day will live, I believe, forever. The story of the Elwha spirit and the Klum-Klum Chinung pulling in Tulalip to participate in the feast, the singing, the drumming, and the teachings. You know, it'll be recorded forever in the minds of our youth.